All right. My own son can personally vouch for the level of engagement that these VR experiences bring with them. So, picking up where Alan left off, I want to tell you a little bit about our Jacobs Institute for Design Innovation, because that is where later on in the morning you can see the Berkeley VR Club show demos, and we'll also have some hands-on design and making activities as well. So the Jacobs Institute for Design Innovation launched just a year ago. So last year at Homecoming, we actually had a talk over there, and it had only been 3 or 4 weeks that we have moved into the building. So if you were there last year, come on back and see how the place has changed. And if you think about the kinds of products that Alan just showed, the VR headsets, the controllers, what is characteristic about them is that they unite some physical product design, electronics inside, and software that together define the experience. And what the Jacobs Institute was really designed to enable our students to do is to work across all of these different domains: mechanical, electrical, engineering, computer science, user interface design, visual design, aesthetics. And to do that, we think of what we built as kind of a 21st century workshop. So think of iconic workshops of the past. The bicycle workshop of the Wright brothers that allowed them to build the first controllable plane. Or the garage of Hewlett and Packard in Palo Alto that launched much of the success of Silicon Valley. So what is a 21st century workshop for the kinds of products that Alan just showed? Well, I think it combines access to powerful design software, digital fabrication tools, and ubiquitous programmable electronics. So as a computer scientist myself, I'm really interested in, you know, what are the software tools we use to build the products of the future? And so we at Berkeley have a long history of creating and then giving away open source CAD software in mechanical, electrical, and code domains. Another interesting trend that has enabled this 21st century workshop is the rapid falling in price of industrial manufacturing and fabrication equipment. So this may not be as fast as Moore's Law, but you can already buy for, you know, $1,000 or less a 3D printer that has some of the same capabilities as industrial manufacturing equipment. Now, of course, it's not as large. You're not going to process all the same kinds of materials, but it's now within the reach of all of our students on campus to work with these machines and create physical products according to their specifications. And then finally, we've seen, you know, Moore's Law not only making our desktop computers and laptops ever faster and cheaper, but it's also pushed computation into nearly every product we can hold in our hands and use in our lives. So it now costs 10 cents to have a chip inside your product that runs some code. It maybe costs $1 to $5 to have it run a whole operating system like your laptop does. And so in the Jacobs Institute, we bring all of the tools to work across all of these domains together across multiple floors. And I'll invite you to come see our makerspace and some of our advanced fabrication facilities later on. Here are just a couple of impressions to whet your appetite. This is our first floor makerspace. And here is some of the 3D printing equipment that we'll have on display. So right after the session, we have an open house. You just head out this door, go across the street, and right past Soda Hall, we'll welcome you there. Now, the Jacobs Institute has a teaching mission, but we also have a research mission. And one of the areas where we conduct research is in interaction and immersion, so connecting directly to the topics that Alan presented. And when I think of augmented cognition, I actually think of another Berkeley alum who basically started this entire field. And that was Doug Engelbart, who was an EE grad student in the 50s. He wrote a report in the 60s on augmenting the human intellect. You might also know him as the inventor of the mouse, of word processing, of basically hyperlinked documents and real-time collaboration software. And he did all of this in the 60s. But he did it because what he was after was augmenting our intellect and cognition. And so the key quote here from this report is, how do we augment our intellect? Well, we want to enable people to have more rapid comprehension, better comprehension, or comprehending a situation that previously was too complex for us. And we want to come up with solutions faster, solutions that are better, and find solutions in domains that were too complicated for us. So we want to be able to tackle faster, better, more complex problems, and we want to comprehend them and find new solutions. So how might this vision actually play out in some concrete projects? Well, let's take a quick look at comprehension. So I think of augmented reality as not just something that happens in a headset, but that also could happen at room scale. And what I find really inspiring is a vision by a colleague of ours, Brett Victor, who said, what we really want to create in educational settings are seeing spaces. Think of a room-sized microscope that is entirely designed around understanding what the project we're trying to build is doing and what it might not be doing. So you might have children who are taking our electrical engineering courses, or you might have taken them yourself in the past. And so you've probably come face to face with one of these. Right? It's a breadboard for building a circuit. The breadboard itself was actually great innovation. You could plug things together very quickly. But what if things don't work? Well, then you're staring at this rat's nest. And traditionally, what people have done is then you take out your tools and you probe point by point, take single measurements, what could be wrong? So here's another vision of what augmentation could do for you. Here's a smart breadboard where every single row is instrumented, and we'll show you measurements of voltages of every single row in real time. And as you build your circuit, you know, we update that. And then when something goes wrong, I can also model my circuit. And so here I have actually plugged in an LED and a resistor. And then when something goes wrong, like I have my LED inserted backwards, right? We can automatically debug the physical world now, because we have ubiquitously instrumented it, and we can say what we expected there to be didn't show up. So here are the types of mistakes that could have caused this problem. All right, so that's in the realm of electronics. Let's look at the realm of physical construction. We've been really interested in the domain of augmented tools. So think of a spectrum of automation and intelligence. If you pick up a hammer, there's no automation and no intelligence. Right? You're doing all the work. If you hit go on a 3D printer, everything is completely automated. You load in a digital design file, and the machine intelligently executes all of those instructions. Now, if you go to Home Depot and pick up a power tool, you bought yourself a motor on a stick. So you have some automation. It saves you physical effort, but there's still no intelligence. And so the question is, what might be in this space in between? Here's one take. We've been working on augmented power tools, where we take off-the-shelf power tools and we add the kinds of sensors and actuators that you might otherwise find in robotics to them. So here are some distance sensors, like the kind you find in your cell phone that turns your screen off when you put the phone to your ear, and a projector that now can give us augmented reality based on the tool itself. So for example, you can load on a set of instructions into your tool, like drill a perpendicular 12-millimeter blind hole, and as you perform the action, the tool gives you real-time feedback. And so you can think of loading entire project instructions into your workshop. All right, let's talk about performance a bit as well. So as Alan mentioned, this recent wave in AR was started by Google Glass, and some students investigated how to use Google Glass to interact with your physical environment. So here the idea is you look at a device in your environment, like a light or a TV, and you immediately get a control interface for that device delivered on your near-eye display. So you look at the TV, tap, there's the remote for your TV. You look at the light, there's a virtual light switch. And let me just finish up by also mentioning that we don't just do this work for productivity domains, like for engineering and for building, but there's also a huge opportunity to apply these technologies in the arts as well. right now, one of our bottlenecks is actually the gesture recognition. So it turns out that if you try HoloLens, that this gesture is very limiting in the kind of richness you can express. Think of, you know, what a skilled guitarist will do, the degrees of freedom they'll exert with their hands compared to clicking with one finger. Now, in the medical domain, people have come up with very sophisticated interfaces, like this remote surgery interface. And we're really interested in pushing that into the artistic domain as well. So here's an early precursor of a electronic musical instrument that you play with your hands, so your hands are augmented. This was not done at Berkeley, this was done in Amsterdam by Michael Weisswisch. But it's really inspired us to also look at augmented performance. So for example, with the Center for New Music and Audio Technology and the College of Engineering, we're collaborating on augmented dance performances, where dancers wear wearable sensors such as heart rate monitoring, and that data gets sent in real time to the musicians, who then rescore and adapt their performance live in response to the biosignals of the dancer. So that's my brief overview of where we're headed in augmented cognition. So we want to do faster, better, but also solve entirely new problems and do it through better comprehensions and better solutions. Thank you.